We could have the best youth group in the whole nation. We could spend millions of dollars. We could give away big screen TVs. We could have Jesus run our youth ministry. But if it's not happening in the homes, then there's going to be a disconnect. If we gotta start somewhere, I say a life that's successful, a life that's purposeful, a life that has meaning, a life that has fruit. When we see some biblical examples of this, we see in Psalms where it says that a tree planted by streams of water will bear fruit in season. That it's talking about there someone that's planted in the Word of God, that knows the Word of God, they will always produce fruit. Chapter 6, we see an amazing portion of Scripture where God really tells his people, this is what I want to make sure you know that's on your heart, and this is what I want you to pass on to your biological children, your spiritual children. I want you to pass this on to the generation. So we're going to take a look at this. In here, there's a lot of nuggets of wisdom here, but we're going to take a look at five specific things that this tells us to do. The first three have to do with the heart of an individual. And we're going to take a look specifically at the heart of a parent. It says you have to have these three things before you can pass on anything to your kids. And those three things, we can summarize them like this. You have to have a love for God. A personal love for God. You have to know God. You have to know the grace of God. You have to know what he has done for you. You have to love God with everything you have. That's the first important principle that God is saying, I need you to have this. The second thing is you need to have my word on your heart. Not just knowing basic Bible stories or going to a church that preaches God's word, which is a good thing, but having God's word on your heart. Meditating on it, having it as part of your memory, having it, wielding it as a sword, having the word of God on your heart, on your lips, in your mind. You have to have that. The next thing he says is that you must have a lifestyle of worship. There's an amazing part of this, this scripture that says, not only do you have God's word on your heart and you teach it formally to your kids, but you teach them as you sit down at the table. You teach them as you walk along the road. You teach them as you put them to bed at night. It's not going to be real. It's just going to be words. It's not going to be authentic unless it is on your heart, unless you have a lifestyle of worship, a lifestyle dedicated to the Lord, a lifestyle that preaches to your kids every day. It's a sermon. Your whole life is a sermon to your kids. Your whole life is an illustration to your kids. Your whole life is showing them who God is and the kind of person that you want them to become. You need to diligently teach, formally and informally, structured and informal. You need to teach them all together with your Bibles out. You need to teach them as you work. You need to teach them as you do chores. You need to teach them as you go along the way. You need to teach them as they fail or you fail. You teach them with everything that you do. And then the next thing is the Word of God needs to have a prominent role in your family, in your home, in your lives. They took this very literally. They literally would take God's Word and put it in the structures of their home so they could see it everywhere that they went. And God is calling us to take God's Word seriously and make it a prominent part of the flow of our home, where God's Word is just a part of everything that we're doing. Talking about, meditating on, memorizing, singing about, playing games with God's word. This is a holistic view of what God is saying here. This is the life of a parent that is living out a lifestyle of worship. Our temptation as parents is to do the last two only. We want to diligently teach. We want to tell our kids what God's word says, but we skip the first three. And that's where there's a disconnect. That's where kids really don't get it because they hear the words that we're saying, but they don't see it lived out in our lives, and they don't see it as real. This is the type of life that's worth passing on to the next generation. This is how the faith is going to continue and last past your days on earth. We could have the best youth group in the whole nation. We could spend millions of dollars. We could give away big screen TVs. We could have Jesus run our youth ministry. But if it's not happening in the homes, then there's going to be a disconnect. I don't want your kids to look up to me. I want your kids to look up to you. I want to play a key role in their life, and I want to put others in their life that will play a key role in their life, but all of those are terribly diluted substitutes for mom and dad. The question we have to ask ourselves is, what's the most important thing in our life? What are we worshiping? What are we worshiping? What are we giving our devotion to in our homes, in our lives? Our kids will take the same things that we devote our lives to, and they will devote their lives to them too. First off, the great commandment, to love the Lord your God with all of our heart, meaning having a relationship with him, a real relationship, like a relationship we would have with a human being where we spend time with them. The next thing is loving the Lord your God with all of your mind. This is the education of the mind, the engagement of the mind in learning about who God is, learning the facts of who he is, learning his statutes, learning his law, learning how he's, for generations and generations, proven himself to be faithful. This is engaging our mind and loving God with all of our mind. Next, loving God with all of our strength. Day by day, minute by minute, relying on him to be our sustenance, to be our daily bread. It's so poignant in the Bible how it tells us to ask for our daily bread. We need our daily bread every single day. And he says, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is sufficient for you. Loving God with all of our strength. And lastly, loving the Lord your God with all of your soul. Holistic living. You know, Christianity is the only worldview or world religion that embraces both the physical and the spiritual. That says the God of the universe is a spiritual being that was here before all things. He's the first cause of all things, that he is God, he is spirit, but he also came down and walked this earth as a man. What an amazing thing. Our soul is exactly like that. It's the physical us, it's the spiritual us, it's the mental, emotional, it's our whole being called to. The next thing is to love our neighbors as ourselves. And I love this picture because it's the picture of hands stretched out. Hands stretched out. This is the exact opposite of my nature every day. I wake up every day and I close my hands. I try to hold myself close. I try to not. But God asks us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. That means living an open-handed life, having a generosity of spirit, having eyes wide open to the hurting people around us. Is the Great Commission. And this, I put this picture as representing the Great Commission because what the Great Commission is to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. It's what we're called to do, to go and make disciples. And we want to see that happen in the context of relationships. That's where discipleship plays out, is in the context of relationships. When we see God's word, there's a lot to it. There's a lot to this thing called church and ministry and even youth ministry. But when you boil it down, really it comes down to relationships. This isn't a call to ministers. This isn't a call to adults. This isn't a call to outgoing people. It's a call to all of us. As soon as we become a disciple, we're supposed to go and make disciples. Where we want to start to have a view that's more like this, where we see not only the world and the needs of the world and what God is doing all over the world, but we see that God holds the world in his hand, that he is a global God, he is a missional God, he is the God of all history, he's the Alpha, the Omega. We need to have this view for our life. And all these things taken into consideration, we see what it's like to have a life that is thriving. And all of these for the glory of God. The Bible tells us that the heavens declare the glory of God and the sky shows his handiwork. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. This is the story. This is the story of what it means to have real life. To accept the fact that there's nothing good that we can ever do to please God. It's not by our works. We can't boast in anything that we can do. None of us. And no one that's lived throughout history and no one in the future can boast about their own good deeds. But it's by grace that we've been saved, that we've been united with God. And we are his workmanship and we have a job to do. Tonight's the night for the sinners and the saints. To accomplish this purpose, we want to seek a structure that will best allow and encourage these purposes in our young adults and their families. So that's the reason why we do what we do. When you send your students out of your home, when you send your kids out of your home, you are sending them out and asking them to walk a narrow road. So we need them to be in community together, to lock arms together and pray for one another. Tonight's the night.